Hello, knights, and welcome to another nighttime podcast. I am Poseidon H2O, or Conrad, and I'm sitting here with...
You've got Battle Beast here, also known as Gordon.
And I am Dongvers, also known as Jace. And we have a special guest this podcast. We have the man himself, the triple dot, Since Spacies, otherwise known as Brian.
Oh, thank you. That was a really, really warming welcome there. Yeah, you got Brian here, and yeah, my channel is Since Spacies, and this is a real honor. I'm glad to be here.
Oh, we're happy to have you.
Super happy.
We're going to skip the State of the Union, I almost said. State of the Channel. Oh, wow. Channel. Just because we got a guest, and instead we're going to ask what everyone's been up to this week. We'll start with our honored guest, Brian. What have you been doing lately?
Well, this week seems like it was such a down week considering the week before. I had EB Expo, Electronic Boutique Gaming Expo, and on the same week we had Xbox Fan Fest, which I'll go into a little more later on the chat, but that was a huge week for me.
Yeah, I remember. Sorry, Gordo, go ahead.
No, I just, no kidding. That is a huge week, man. Yeah. It's impressive you can do all that.
Yeah, the highlight for me in the Fan Fest was the drifting. That was some pretty sick stuff.
Yeah, that was a cool video. I watched the hell out of that one. That punk music you're picking too, is that like local? Is that local Australian stuff usually, or
what's that? Sorry,
the punk music you put in some of your videos, is that local stuff?
Or? I'm glad you asked that. Yeah, so it's royalty free because they're disbanded. It's a band called Blister, and they come from Brisbane. And when they were still live and active, I was getting really into them. With my brother was the one that put me onto them. And then just when you think, yeah, this is the next big band, they just drifted off and dropped off the planet. It's really unfortunate. And a lot of Australian bands do that, unfortunately.
Oh, wow. Yeah. I know I like all kinds of music, but there is a special place in my heart for punk rock. I don't know why. I just love it.
The highlight for me in that video was the don't trust the fast food chains. If you listen back on that channel, on that video, you'll see that there's burping and cows mooing and stuff in the background. That's great.
Man, well, if you say, unfortunately, Australian bands fall off the face of the earth, I can think of one Canadian band that I wish would fall off the face of the earth, and they're from Hannah. Conrad, you know who they are.
Nickelback. Oh, Nickelback. I thought you were going to say Beaver.
Listen
for a
here.
Second.
They are Canadian Albertan treasure, you asshole.
Have you ever been to Hannah? Hannah is the asshole of the prairies, Dongvers. You just simmer down over there.
I drive through there like every week for work, man.
And they have, they're so proud. It's on their fucking sign right at the start. Like, Nickelback's from here. Like, so's Lanny McDonald. He was cool.
Hang on. Did I actually have that on there? Welcome to the
yep.
State or province? Or
No, just the town. The town sound.
Yeah, it's like, the town. Oh, okay, no, that's right. I thought if it was to the state, I was thinking calm down. But, okay.
Province. But yeah,
province. Sorry, Australian states. States. I'm used to states. Sorry.
I actually don't have a problem with Hannah, that asshole of the world or Prairie's comment was just a joke. But I really do hate Nickelback, and I always will.
Thanks for clarifying.
Well, I used to play soccer in Hannah and stuff. I always had a good time there. Uh-huh. I went to the hospital there once. They were delightful.
On one street, crazy.
It's more than here. We have zero. Or we have one. Sorry, zero on one. I was thinking, I don't know. My brain was wrecked. I had one beer, so I'm done.
Yeah.
I was in Canada recently.
I was in Canada about 2 months or 3 months back.
I saw your video about it, too. He saw bears and everything.
I saw bears, seven of them, just being bears. And it was pretty cool. And I was getting ready to run. Just at any minute.
I was fishing one time, me and a buddy, and we're just minding our own business, you know, drinking a few beers, walking along, fishing every now and then. We're walking up and down this river, and we both got this weird feeling, like the hairs in the back of your neck stand up. And we look across, and it's not a wide part of the river, and we look over, and there's a cougar standing there. just staring at us. I have never been so scared of an animal in my life. I mean, I've seen bears and stuff, but a cougar? Oh, I don't know what it is about them, man. They freaked the hell out of me. So we took off. We kept walking. Made ourselves look big.
I think one of the highlights for me driving in both Canada and also towards the Grand Canyon when I went down to the States was the signs that you see for animals that you're just not used to seeing. Like there was a sign in Grand Canyon for pumas ahead. I'm like, I want to get a photo of that sign.
You press off a few moose crossing signs too.
Well, you'll probably see a lot of signs because, especially in Alberta near the mountains, we have a lot of Asian tourists that don't understand how dangerous these animals are.
Yeah, and it's not even just the Asian tourists. It's all kinds of stupid people will just get tourists up there.
Yeah, yeah.
Every time I go through Banff, or man, it's just like they just pull over like 15 cars and their tour buses, and they're like walking up as close as they can. Even elk will get very, like, if you get too close to it, will come after you.
I'm guilty. I pulled over when we because we saw a whole stack of other cars pulled over. What's going on? So we pulled over, and there was an elk in the bush, and we got our tourist shot, and we got out of there.
Yeah, that's fine. It's when they try to go down into the bush with the elk. That's when it gets sketchy. Yeah. That and I've seen people hold their hand out the window with food. Well, there's a bear 10 feet away from the car.
Yeah, well, I was going to come to you, man.
What are you doing?
I was Waterton not that long ago, which is in the south of Alberta by the mountains, right along the U.S. border. And they're having bear problems. So many tourists are feeding the bear, so they're coming right up to people now, right? Oh. And it's not going to lead to something good.
No, it's just going to lead to the bears being shot.
I saw that expression for the first time. A fed bear is a dead bear. I've never heard of that before because it's just not something we have to deal with in Australia.
Yeah.
And that got me really concerned of like, well, what about ones that are fed? That's pretty sad.
Well, yeah, because I mean, maybe once they don't, but if they get used to it, they'll come into towns and raid garbage cans and all kinds of stuff. And then, you know, what are they going to do? They can try to move them, but if that same bear comes back, then they generally shoot them just to make sure they don't continue.
You'll see a lot of bear-proof trash bins nowadays.
Yeah, I saw a bit of that when I was over there, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So, now that our exciting wildlife talk is over, what have you been up to lately, Beast?
Oh, man, this week, well, I mean, unfortunately, like, when I work, I have to leave home for the majority of the week, and this week was a long week, so we work an extra day, so I didn't get home till late yesterday. And and I had to work. Oh, man, like, I have a story, true story, happened to not a friend of a friend of mine, but happened to me. I can't tell it on the podcast, but you know what? I will give you the PG-13 version. I got sexually assaulted at McDonald's.
That's PG-13?
Yeah.
Well, that's as far as he's going to go.
Like, I got groped. it was, and of all places, you're in Wetaskiwin, and it's like, man, I want to tell people, but what I did confirm is sexual assault is funny, because I laughed, and I laughed.
I'm going to keep it PG, but sexual assault, that shit's hilarious.
That is when it happens to me. Oh. Super funny.
But yeah, so I can see that. Was it Ronald McDonald, was it?
No. But how did you know it was at McDonald's? Did I say that?
Yes, you did say that. You did.
Oh, okay,
you
good. I thought I didn't mention the
No, he's just psychic. Why do you think he's on here, man? He's going to tell us our futures.
Dude, it was something else. But anyways, I got home late yesterday, and since then, even right up to the time of this podcast, I have been honing my Rocket League skills, getting better. Unfortunately, I've been playing on the console more and more because I like to play on the big screen. But the skills are transferable. I played on Steam on the PC just before, and still scoring tons of goals and hoops.
Sorry, I've got to cut in there. Why you say unfortunately?
The Rocket League on the console is nerfed compared to the PC because there is a setting that you can't access on the console called Dead Zone for the controllers. And a few patches ago, the big patch before Rumble, they updated the controller input, just the default settings, and you have to go into an actual text file in Steam, in your Steam files, to edit it, to get it back. And what it is, it added a bunch of Dead Zone on your thumbsticks, so you can't basically what it did is it made the turning and the thumbsticks less reactive. So you, you have a 0.1 of a dead zone, whereas on Steam or the old before the patch, there was a 0.01 dead zone. I mean, that's a big difference. So you can, on Steam, you can go in and manually fix that. On the console, you can't. So no matter how good you are, the best Steam player of Rocket League is going to be better than the best Xbox One player. Probably, I don't think the PlayStation 4 is any different, just because they can't fix that controller dead zone. They can't tweak those default settings of making your controller reactive. And so aerials are less impressive. People are pulling off less impressive things. You can't customize the controller for air rolls. Like, you can do a thing called the tornado on the PC, where you jump, you hold air roll left or right, and you rotate your left thumbstick the opposite way. You can never do that on the Xbox. It's impossible, just because they don't let you customize the controls.
But we always figured that that was going to be a problem when they introduced cross-platform gameplay online.
Yeah, it is a thing. Fortunately, nobody, as far as I know, is modding, but there is a program on the PC called Rocket League Trainer, which, if you have not tried it, you should definitely will bring your game to the next level. But people who play on consoles will never get to access that third-party program.
Huge advantage.
It's so good for training. Basically, it takes free play, and it just customizes things. Like, it just sets you up for aerials, sets you up for goals. You can customize your own plays.
You basically set up your own practice.
Yeah, like, you basically set up your own practice, where the ball is traveling here at this speed, at this trajectory. You know, and console players will never get the benefit of that. They can play split screen.
We can't.
Yeah,
that'd be fun.
They can play split screen, but yeah, no. So I love playing on the console. I really do. But when you transfer back to the PC, and because I have my default settings corrected to the original of what Rocket League was, you know, two or three large patches ago, the game is different. It's just, it's more reactive. You can fly easier. You can do more. You can pull off better, you know, aerial tricks. It's just that next level. But I definitely play more on the console now than I do on the PC, just because it's on the big screen on my couch and it's a comfort thing, right? So that's my spiel on that. And that's, you know, at the end of the day, console Rocket League will never be as elevated as PC Rocket League, even though they're both super, super fun.
Mm-hmm. Well, that was long-winded.
But I hope it was detailed.
No, it was actually
to be fair.
Exactly. Anyone who's looking for why their Rocket League changed, that'll answer the question. Mm-hmm. Bombers, you've been busy the last little while.
Yeah. Well, I bought a condo. So me and my girlfriend got all moved into that and just getting settled and all that kind of stuff. So, for gaming stuff, I've mostly just been playing World of Warcraft. My guild has been cleared all of normal, Emerald Nightmare, and we're on to Heroic. I think we got the first two bosses down of Heroic, so we're doing all right.
Nice. What about your pal Sadie?
Oh yeah, I also got a puppy, so that's fun. She's a quarter Newfoundland Retriever, and then the rest is all Great Pyrenees. So she's gonna be a big dog.
Yeah, she's gonna make Blitz look like a tiny. She's gonna make Blitz look like Zoe. And if you guys know my dogs, that's a huge difference. I guess I should explain. My dog Blitz is a German Shepherd, and our dog Zoe is a Shih Tzu crossed with something else. I can't remember at the moment. So that's
first dog.
Yeah, that is going to be a big difference.
What about you, Brian? Do you have any dogs or pets?
I've got two cats, Mimi and Fufu.
No way. No.
And the funny thing is, with the Fufu was the first cat we got, and we got this second cat. They're both rescue cats, and we're sitting there for about a day or so wondering what to call the second cat. One of our neighbors go, "Well, you've already got Fufu. You've got to have a Mimi." And I went, "Nah, that's ridiculous." And then my wife comes home after being at work, and she goes, "We're going to call her Mimi." I'm like, "Hang on a minute. Did you talk to our neighbor or something? How did you both come up with the same name? So it ended up being Mimi. We had no choice. You're not a cat person, are you?
I love cats. I don't know.
Okay. Like French. Just not those names.
he's not into the names. I didn't even know Beast owned a dog until like 6 months ago. And how long have we known each other? And how long have you had that dog?
Well, it's same. It's I guess it's kind of a rescue. A real close friend's father passed away, and they had two dogs, and whoever was taking the other dog couldn't take. They just didn't have. They already had like four dogs, so they couldn't take both. So this one is kind of dog I would always kind of want. It's a super old dog, and those are my favorite.
Yeah, because they just lay around.
They just lay around and sleep. They wake up for 2 seconds and then they go back to sleep.
Well, that's why I was wondering, because you never had mentioned him or her. I'm not sure. And then all of a sudden, you're just like, yeah, the dog is barking. I got to go see what's going on. And I was like, dog? What are you talking about?
But yeah, same thing. So I didn't go out and get it. I was like, I'll take the dog. And I don't know if she'll make another year, but... Well, she's cool.
Well, hopefully she does.
Yeah. She's all right. she's really weird. She's always walking around the house looking for something, but...
Could be her other dog friend, maybe?
It's probably the other dog, which was her puppy, so... But they're...
Oh, she's like, oh, I lost my puppy.
I guess they were together for 7 years or 6 years, and then they were... said person passed away, then they got split. But she seemed she looked for her owner for sure for the first year, and then after that she was good, and then all of a sudden she starts looking again, like, oh, okay.
Weird.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe you should just give her more attention. Be a pal.
I try. Well, she's like almost like a cat, where if she doesn't want to be petted or hang out, she's just leaving and go to her dog bed. And if you even go near a dog bed, she doesn't bark or bite, but she just like stares at you, pissed off. You know? Like,
what are you doing?
Two words. It's bugger off. That's all it is. Yeah, man.
All right. I think we can move on to questions now.
Yeah.
I think that's probably... Oh, I haven't been doing much. I've been making videos and working... That's it. I don't even go out of the house most of the time. I don't know why I go last, because I just bring down the whole segment because I never do anything.
And you never get sexually assaulted.
Maybe next week I'll get sexually assaulted. Yeah, I don't know why we shouldn't joke about that. We used to in college.
What's that?
Actually, if we kept scoring in college, I was way behind.
I'm starting to remember less and less of college.
Yeah. I mean, it's almost 10 years. How did that happen?
Yeah, I don't know. Well, my 10-year high school thing came and went, I was like, awesome, man. And it kind of is an eye-opener, because that's a decade, man. And
my 20th is coming up. Well, actually, I guess my 15th would have been last year. Well, you can't be that much older than me, Brian.
Okay, so my last year of high school, which is year 12, was 91, and straight after that went straight into work. And, well, I think you're going to find out what that first place of employment was.
Yeah, 91. Yeah, mine was 2000, so I guess... A little older than I thought you were, but not too much.
Just a
older.
Few hockey seasons on you.
Yeah, yeah.
And, wow, I was 4 years old.
Dongver's is 12, so.
Yeah, I'm a youngin'.
Dongver's, you were born in 91, weren't you?
Yeah.
No kidding.
I just did math in my head. I was like, shit. Oh, man. Well, there you go. Now, sorry if you feel old after that one, Brian, but he makes us all feel old.
I'm used to it. All right, you get used to it.
You should try standing beside him sometime. You're going to feel short. Doesn't matter how tall you are.
Actually, I'll be honest with you, though. I'm glad I'm at the age that I am, because I got to witness like, my channel's called Since Spacies, so I've got to witness gaming from its very, very start.
Yeah,
so
yeah, that is true.
As I've grown up, gaming's grown up with me. I've seen it mature to what it is today, this multi-billion-dollar industry. But when I was a kid, it was just like you admitted to only a handful of selected people that you were a gamer because that was a nerdy thing that you used to get beaten up for if you got to the wrong people.
Yeah, it takes time. Oh, were you around for that whole, the gamer, the game industry collapse? It was at 89, late 83. 80s, something? Like
it was 82, or 83. 83 so was that, when E.T. supposedly brought the whole industry down.
Right.
We all know it wasn't E.T. in particular, but just the way they went
that
about.
That was like the that straw that broke the camel's
pinnacle.
Back.
That was like pinnacle of what was going wrong with the industry. At the
and
time.
So you remember that very kind of vividly. You know what caused that or no?
I was only nine. So you know, you talk to a 9 year old about financial economics. They're just going to go, "Great, where's the games?"
Well, I just wondered because I often wonder if we're not.
Oh, we lost him.
Another one.
Sorry, we lost him there.
Oh, lost me.
Yeah, for a second.
Sorry, you cut out.
Oh, okay, sorry. Well, I was wondering, I guess maybe it's not the, now that I know you're only nine, but maybe I can just bring it up anyway. Do you think we're heading for another, maybe a micro or mini crash just because of all the, you know, the DLC and the pay-to-play and the pay-to-win schemes and nothing's new and original. And you see, like, Bethesda is now, they're so big that they stick to something safe and you don't get the wonder and amazement and the quality of games and... I don't know. Is there anything today? Is there any parallels, you guys, or you know, Brian, or anybody that thinks that are we headed for that, or is it just too big right now with you know, esports and League of Legends and everything just being so massive that you know, it's the largest and fastest growing entertainment media out there.
I think the industry is big enough to support itself at the moment, but there are going to be some. Casualties over the next few years if people don't adapt to what's happening.
Fingers crossed, EA.
That's what I was going to mention.
Anytime soon. But I think that I'm looking at Nintendo with, like, they're on, I don't know if it's their last chance, but they need to do something to keep up. I think we'll talk more about it, I guess, a little bit in a second with the Switch, if that's going to be enough to save them. Because the Wii U, like, they just came off the big mega successful console of the Wii and then went into this downward spiral with the Wii U. No one knew what the hell that console was supposed to be. They launched the trailer for that one and everyone's coming away with all questions like, what the hell did we just see? Is that an add-on for the Wii? They thought it was supposed to be just a tablet that you buy to play Wii games and no one knew what the hell it was.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was a disaster.
It was a mega disaster, and I got it when I was watching it, but I'm a gamer, so I look out for the cues of what the console that they're launching is going to be about. But, you know, the average person on the street, you'd ask them, so have you heard of the Wii U? Oh, is that bowling thing? They just didn't even know what it was. The marketing was just an absolute fail. So moving on, I think the Switch needs to... They need to absolutely bombard advertisement out there to get the message out of what it's about. And they can't rely on social media alone because the NX has been rumored for almost 2 years now. It's been bouncing around of what it's going to be, etc. And there are still people out there that don't even know what the NX was supposed to be about. Oh, Nintendo's doing a new console? I didn't hear. So,
yeah,
you know.
They got to really do actual commercials on actual TV.
Yeah.
Because that's where the older crowd comes from. And honestly, I think Nintendo, that's kind of, it's not necessarily the older crowd they're going for, but those people are buying it for their kids. And they still watch TV. You know what I mean?
It's funny you watch that last Switch trailer. There was no kids in that video.
No, I noticed that, actually. It was weird.
And there was also no one over 35, which I'm a bit right about.
I'll be there with you next year, buddy.
I've seen two trailers for the Switch, and the one thing that I kind of thought was, I don't know, I didn't think it was their best decision to show, you know, what the Switch was going to be used for, but they showed it. Oh, here you can take it on the airplane. You can play Skyrim on the go. Like, Skyrim is 6 years old, man. Like, are you not?
Well, they're bringing out the remaster. Though they said Skyrim remastered.
Oh, yeah. I didn't.
Yeah, really? It's a remaster. And
I couldn't tell that from the screenshots.
Well, no. Bethesda hasn't actually gone out and said and confirmed, yes, we're releasing it. But why would you put that in the trailer if they're not going to release it? It's just totally ridiculous. Maybe it might be on almost the same level as the Xbox One. Again, we're just speculating. But that's what I've heard on some channels out there, saying that this console could be, if not as powerful as Xbox One, but maybe slightly more powerful. Could you imagine a handheld with Xbox One capability? That's insane. That's pretty cool.
Let's say PS4 ability. I hate my Xbox One.
I'm about to get my first Xbox. My first PlayStation 4 in about 2 weeks from now. So can't wait for that.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, let me know, because I've been on the razor's edge of converting after being with Xbox since the original. Just because the Xbox One is so bad for me.
Yeah, I mean, it plays games fine, but you use it for all kinds of other stuff that you don't like it for.
Yeah, sorry, the games... Well, Rocket League froze twice on me today, but...
Oh, really?
Yeah, in general, the games are okay fine, but anything else, which they... Then, you know, it's a gaming console. No, they advertise it as the end-all, be-all of your home entertainment system, and every app I try to use with it is awful. The whole thing needs to be restarted constantly because your apps semi-freeze, internet... The YouTube, Netflix, they all semi-freeze.
I think Phil Spencer, by the way, who I met.
nice.
he has done quite a good job of getting away from, I don't know what the first head of Xbox name was before him, but that was a train wreck of a reveal.
It wasn't so bad.
Didn't he come out the Rock? Didn't do one reveal? It was Bill Gates and The Rock. Anyways, off topic, sorry. But
yeah, oh, that's the bad, original Xbox. Yeah, that's cringeworthy. But the Xbox has pulled away from that whole, and you can watch TV in your lounge room and play games. Like, they've moved away from that a lot. They've removed the Kinect. Some people cheer that decision. I'm one of the few that like the Kinect and use it for what it's meant for. Like, I love walking into my house and saying Xbox on, and the whole thing just lights up and comes on, not having to fumble around for remotes. That's just how much do they go for? About $150. It's a $150 universal remote.
Oh. Wow. That's where you and me are different.
It wasn't the Kinect that people didn't want. It was the privacy, where the Xbox One had the ability to turn on the Kinect to the camera and record without ever you knowing or you turning it on. That's what people said. Hey, get rid of that, keep the Kinect, and they just said no, we're getting rid of it. So
they were selling blank covers for it, weren't they? Like, people can go out and buy that plastic bit to go over the top of the camera.
Well, I just put a post-it note on the old Kinect.
Well, you could do that.
versatile.
A little did you know, I was actually part of the pilot program for the original Kinect. I got a Kinect for free. Yeah, so I received my Kinect when it was still called Project Natal on Natal, whatever.
Oh,
it was. Yeah. And I wasn't allowed to go on social media about it. I had no way of being able to tell anyone about it, but there was nothing against people coming over to my house and playing it. So I get my mate to come over, and I said, yeah, you can play it, no problems, but just don't put any pictures or anything like that about it. So he plays Kinect Sports, and we're doing the bowling, and he goes, oh, I wonder if you can bowl over him, you know, like cricket style. He smashes my light. The light just goes flying. But it turns out you could bowl over him in bowling.
Well, speaking of Xbox, you were at the Xbox Fan Fest or whatever, and I saw videos and stuff. Yeah, how did that go?
Man, that was awesome. It was like 3 days worth of just nonstop handouts and giveaways. And but for me, it wasn't the handouts were nice. I mean, I'm looking at my limited edition Xbox One controller now, which I've got. It's $110 value. Everyone gets one. Win Oprah Winfrey style.
Nice.
But for me, it was being able to talk to other gamers, which is why I started my channel to begin with. I wanted a lot of the people at my work, they don't game, they're not into gaming, and you talk to them about game, you're excited about a new game, and they're just looking at you going, what's like, they're just yeah, exactly. I go into work with all my gaming shirts, they're just looking at me going like, do you have anything that's like, you know, not for kids? So anyway, back to the Xbox Fan Fest, though. That was awesome. We got to it really highlighted some of the great parts of Sydney, and it was kind of like an opportunity for Phil Spencer to just capture all the great things that this city's got to offer. It was really fantastic going out to the drag racing. Like, I'm a bit of a rev head. I'm not really I don't know all the engine parts or anything like that, but I appreciate the V8 racing that we've got, the scene that we've got here in Australia, and seeing the drag racing between the two Australian cars that are in the Forza Horizon 3 going up the quarter mile. That was awesome seeing that. But I don't know if you guys have seen the video, but the drift racing, I highly recommend anyone, if you ever get the chance to it. Yeah. Like, I went home, there was just bits of rubber all over me, and you couldn't escape it.
Man, and you did it, like, in the car, too. That was so cool. I thought,
yeah,
I was like, man, how did those guys not kill anybody in those cars? It's
crazy.
There
was no accidents all day long. They were doing four cars at every given time. So there's two segregated tracks, so two cars versus each other at the same time. And they were going for 4 hours nonstop, and they had multiple cars that were, you know, coming in to sort of substitute for each other. And
well, they probably needed to change tires.
Well, maybe that was it, yeah. So I only saw one barrier get hit, and it was not a concrete barrier, thank God. It was just a plastic barrier. And I saw one car, he was really trying to push it as far as he could go towards the end of the day, and he spun out and faced the other way. That was the only thing that we saw that went wrong. So it was a major success, the way those guys handled it. I'd love to know where their what racing team they were to give him a plug, but maybe later.
Yeah, it was cool. I'm not usually into drifting. I like I'll watch those Ken Block's Gymkhana videos. But
they're insane.
That's about as much as I get into the drifting side of it, but that was really cool. Like, I thought it was awesome.
And I think it was someone from your channel that pointed out that the ska music on the comments just really adds to the drifting.
Yeah,
it just worked out so well.
Yeah, that was me. I'm usually making the comments and running the Twitter. But,
okay.
Yeah, I do a lot of that. Because I work from home, right? The other guys have to leave for 8 to however many hours a day. Or in Gord's case, he's gone all week usually. So he doesn't have much of a chance.
Oh, so wow.
I do it while I'm working and while I'm not working, whatever. It beeps on my phone. I go check it, see what. But, yeah. What about meeting Phil Spencer there? Because that was at the same one, right?
Yeah, it was so brief, and I'm hopeless with the camera. I still got to get used to videoing, because I'm old school. I think that if you're pointing a camera towards someone, it's kind of rude, but you kind of need to do that for the channel. So yeah. I'm still trying
those
to work out the
so
best.
Those guys are so used to it.
Sorry?
Those guys are so used to it that are PR gentlemen and
yeah, I should have thought about that at the time, but I was too busy just chatting away, because he pointed me out of the crowd because I'm wearing my Penguins jacket at the time, my Penguins jersey.
Yeah.
And he goes, are you from Pittsburgh? And I went, nah, mate.
Way off.
Well, still going to be your Penguins
longitude and latitude.
Here's a question that I know we have an outline we kind of follow. This isn't on it, and I just thought of it right now. How do you ever see games, or do you just like watch over the internet, or what, for the Penguins now?
Okay, so the NHL. Well, for the longest time there, we weren't able to get any access to watching any NHL. But back mid late 80s, early 90s, we could watch it on one channel late at night, one game. That was it. So I used to tape that and watch it over and over and over again. But lately, though, the NHL Pass is available, and it is cheaper for international than it would be for you guys.
Oh, yeah.
So we pay for $120 season pass unrestricted, and so that's how we get our hockey now.
It's not bad. I'm not sure. I think we pay slightly more, but that's about it. And it's unrestricted too.
But isn't it? You can't watch your own local matches.
No, that Sportsnet used to do blackouts like a few years ago, but people got so pissy with it that they don't do it anymore. And
oh, okay.
I haven't seen. I cheer for the Oilers anyway, but I hear my Flames fan friends. I mean, friends. Looking at you, Dongvers. Anyway, I'd hear them complaining about it more often. But because where I live is Calgary is the closer team, so we'd still get the Edmonton games unblocked. But you know, it's weird because like Ottawa games would be blocked for us if I tried to watch a Senators game, because they just blocked it for the whole network because I don't know reasons. Didn't make any sense to me. But yeah, I was just wondering about that, and I didn't think to put it on that one.
The only reason why I follow Penguins, and just to get it out there, I'm in Sydney. I'm in Australia. I've got no attachment or affiliation with any of the teams, to be quite honest. So the first game that I played with hockey was the very first EA hockey that came out. And I've bought every update since until just recently. I've started, like, I haven't bought the latest one.
Oh, sure. Just because the Oilers are good, you don't buy this one. Yeah, okay. I get it.
That's it. No, but I only followed the Penguins because this is lame, but the logo. I liked the logo, and I went with it, and I stuck with it. So, but the funny thing is, it turns out that the Pittsburgh Penguins, they started up in 1967, which is the very same year that my football team, the Cronulla Sharks, they started in 67 as well, the local team that I follow here. And that team won their first premiership, their first grand final in 50 years. They've never won it until now. So it's taken them 50 years or 49 years to get get to hold up the cup. Yeah.
And so, didn't the Penguins win the cup last year?
And they won. My other team won as well. So I'm having an awesome time.
I stopped watching after the first round because I can't just watch hockey anymore. It's got to be my team or I can't. I mean, well, sometimes if I'm at the bar and there's a game on or whatever, you know, but that's different. Anyway, I got us way off track, like I always do.
No, you're right.
Did you have anything else to say about Xbox Fan Fest?
No. So, we got to meet a few local celebrities, probably guys that you would never heard of. I was wearing a Pac-Man shirt, and this guy that he's in a local TV show, which is extremely rude, extremely funny, and if you ever get the chance to see a show called Howzo's, there's so much in jokes for Australians that we get, you guys would not get, but it's just so rude and funny. But the guy, one of the main stars from that show, he was hosting the whole Xbox Fan Fest for the Gears of War launch. And he's come up to me with the cameras and the lights and everything. He's going, "Oh my God, check out this guy. He must have been gaming from like way back." And I'm like, "Yeah, thanks, man." And by this time of the night, I've already had so many, because I was just handing out champagne all night and I'm plastered. But he asked me, "So how long have you been playing for?" Like on the camera, and I've gone, "Since Spacies." So I got my plug for the channel in.
Nice. Oh, that's good. I guess we can move on to the next question. I think it's yours, Brian.
Yes. So this is for all. What is the most expensive console that you've ever bought?
I think I could actually probably go first on this one because you might all hate me. I don't pay as much as most people for consoles. Like, I see something come out, and I don't buy it right away ever because I know in 6 to 8 months, price is going to drop. And whatever, the most I ever spent, it was two different consoles. I spent $199 on my PS2. And I spent $199 replacing my Xbox 360 with the Xbox 360 Elite. And that was it. I have a PS3 that I got. My sister gave me hers because it wasn't working. And is I went
Canadian,
on
Canadian, not American dollars, right?
Canadian dollars. So so about $12 American. I mean, now it is. It seems like, but anyway, my sister gave me her PS3, and I went on Facebook and said, "Hey, does anybody have a PS3 that doesn't work?" And a guy got back to me in 20 minutes, and his had the yellow light of death, and my sister's needed a new hard drive. So I just splashed the hard drive in. Free PS3. It was pretty awesome.
Wow.
I got my $5 Sega Genesis. It still works like a charm. I was like, I don't go all out for anything like that. That's why I don't have an Xbox One yet, because the price isn't where I like it yet. Or a PS4. Either one of them. I'll just wait. Maybe I'll get one used at some point. Whatever works. I can't, actually, you know what? I keep trying to win that freaking Philip DeFranco. He's always giving them away on his channel. And I just never picked us yet. But maybe one day.
Eventually. You know what's interesting? I just looked it up. The Australian Canadian dollar, one Canadian dollar is worth 99 cents Australian right now.
Yeah, it's part for part. Yeah, it's pretty much. Really? In other words, we feel your pain.
Yeah, and you guys get it worse too, because it's. I was gonna say argument, but it wasn't an argument. We were just discussing it in the comments of a video on YouTube, and. I guess is it like $100 to buy a newer game in Australia?
It'd be about that much, yeah.
Yeah, here it's only 80.
Or $120 in some cases.
Oh, wow.
No, it's not 80. It's 80 plus 15 for your first DLC plus $49.99 for your season's pass.
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah. And 60 bucks for your Xbox Live.
I also tend not to buy the DLC. Oh, I do buy Xbox Live every year.
I couldn't get my head around when I was over in Canada is the whole plus tax thing. You do put your price up, but then you've also got to add 15% or something.
Not here. But
you were in BC. Yeah, they have what is it? They have 5% GST and what is their PST? I think it's like 8% or something.
Yeah.
Well, here we only have GST of 5% in Alberta, but we're getting a fucking carbon tax soon because our prime minister and our premier are fucking retarded.
Don't get me started.
I know.
Do it.
That's
don't
it. Do I'm it. Done. That's all I'm saying. And they can both
Alberta is the one province who has not a provincial sales tax, only a federal sales tax, the GST. For long time, my entire life, for sure. Thank you very much to our previous government, but
GST,
the got rid of the debt in here. But then I'm sure it's coming. They've hinted at it. They've tried. Like, what was her name? Redford thought. Like, she threw it out there, and then she got bombarded. So it was like, okay, no.
Well, that's why I think that's why the NDP got in, because Albertans do not do sales tax, but now they're just calling it carbon tax, and then the feds went and did carbon tax as well. So. I don't know.
Don't do it. Rabbit holes. Don't do it.
Yeah. Yes, I know. Okay, yes.
Shut the fuck up.
The swear bear has spoken. It's time to be quiet.
Because
we could go, I could rage about this for hours, but.
Next question. No, most expensive car.
Oh, yeah, yeah. You can go.
Mine.
I'll go. Go ahead. No, Jace, I insist you go.
Okay, I probably Xbox One. I think I bought like the week release of the when it came out there, and I think it was like $500 or something like that. I can't remember exactly, but
yowza.
Yeah, it was big, but it was like the Kinect one and all that shit. So then I get it home and I go to plug in my Kinect, and Kinect doesn't work. So then I had to wait like. I think like 4 months before I could get a new Kinect because they were so backed up or whatever. Mm-hmm. But yeah, that was my most expensive one.
Okay. Well, for me, price tag wise was the Xbox One for sure, just because I bought a Gen 1, like not like maybe 2 months after release. But the most money into a console I've sunk has definitely been the Xbox 360, just because I bought 3 of them, not because I wanted to play them all by myself, but Xbox 360 had an atrocious defect rate of 35% plus. And my first two crapped out. I bought a third one. It crapped out. I was able to fix one with the parts from the first and the second one. And then I bought the, what did you call it, Legacy Edition one, the black one. So I guess I bought 4. Yeah, the Elite. I bought 4 of those, but I guess one of those doesn't count because I fixed using parts from the first and second one. So, but to be fair, I could justify it. Some people skydive, some people go on vacation. I was having so much fun on the 360. I was angry about it, the Red Ring of Death, but I was having ridiculous amounts of fun. I could justify the money I sunk into it. The Xbox One, I could, you know, throw it out the window tomorrow and not miss it. So I'm that price tag. I would never buy another one if it didn't go. I'd go PS4, but I think I'd wait for the Switch now.
We'll get to that a little later.
Yeah.
Well, okay, Brian, what's yours? What's the most expensive one you ever bought? Oh, did we lose Brian?
We might have.
Uh-oh.
Now, we'll get him back, and then we'll just cut this part, and then, like...
Yeah.
It'll be like, you
know... Sorry, back again. I'm back again. Okay. Right. I was just going to say that, it was the Xbox
One. Oh, we lost.
Oh, it's the Xbox One. Sorry? You cut out again a little bit.
Yeah. Oh, sorry. That's all right. Yeah, so Xbox One, $599.
Oh, yeah.
$100 more than I paid.
And... Yeah. But if you go back to 92 or 93, the Mega CD came out here in Australia. I got it for $450. That was after discount. The Mega CD retailed for, which was your Sega CD, it retailed for $699 Australian at the time.
Oh, wow.
Oh, wow. What's Sega CD?
Get the fuck out of my podcast.
Gotcha.
So what's beer?
Oh, that's fine words. Oh, yeah, that's... Man, and some stuff... I remember hearing, like, way back when the first Ataris and stuff were coming out, some of those things were just outrageous. Like, in the States, they were selling for, like, $700 American. Like, that's...
Oh, wow.
But, I mean, those things, back then, they were cutting edge. Who knew how far we'd come, right?
Yeah. But.
Hey, I still would prefer to play combat over most of the stuff that's coming out now.
I got to tell you, I play a lot of old games. I was...
Oh, me too. Don't lie. You guys are psyched for Call of Duty 78.
Yeah, right.
You're the only one who's going to buy a Dongverse.
Yeah, that's true.
It's amazing how far a franchise can go downhill before it completely gets over 1 million dislikes.
Yeah.
Look at you.
Well, that's what happens when you make the same game every time.
Yeah, but this one has Jon Snow on it.
Oh, shit, son!
Oh, why didn't you say so earlier?
You know he's just going to make the wrong tactical choice and you're going to have to, like, bail him out with your sister's army. spoilers. For Game of Thrones.
Oh, well, thanks. I haven't seen a single episode. Not
oh, you'll forget by then. All right, moving on. We have a fan question from @WeirdAndRetro on Twitter. He asks, what is your most memorable or favorite experience working at the hotline? This one's for Brian, obviously. And I would also add to that, what would also be your favorite things about working at the magazines and at the game store?
Yeah, so I think before I answer that, I just let everyone know that not only, and I got to tell you, I find it very hard to keep pronouncing it as Sega, because here in Australia it's pronounced Sega.
Yeah, you can call it Sega if that's, you want. We'll get it.
That's how we always answered it, and the amount of flack I get online for that is just, anyway, moving right
you
along.
You should. Every time you fire up a Sega game, it goes, Sega.
Maybe in Australia it goes... Oi, I will Sega mate. That was bad. I apologize.
I will do a video on why we pronounce it as Sega, but that's another story for another time. What I was also going to say is that I also wrote for Hyper Magazine, which is a Australian and New Zealand video game magazine, which is still up and running today, which I find amazing that they can still be in business when magazines are dying. Format.
Yeah.
And before that, I was working on Megazone magazine, which was actually owned by the distributors of Sega here in Australia. So it was always something that I wanted to do when I left high school, was to write
for a magazine, because I actually had my own magazine, which was a fanzine called the SEGA Times. And that's how I got the job, was sending in copies of my magazine into SEGA, and they eventually caved in and said, we've got to get this guy a job here. So that's how I got a job.
Pester, he keeps harassing me at the bus stop.
Exactly. Kids at home. Kids at home, keep pestering Sony and Xbox and Nintendo with your stuff. They will eventually cave in.
See, I told you guys browsers will eventually accept me. Like, it's just a matter of time.
You just keep sending them those dick pics, Dongvers.
Fan art.
So the most memorable things working at SEGA was seeing and playing Sonic before it came out.
Oh, nice.
I was this was actually before I worked there. I got invited to come in and have a look at this new thing that's going to be bigger than Mario, they were saying. And I'm like, bigger than Mario? All right. We'll see how this works out. And they put me down in front of this Sega Mega Drive, and they had this circuit board sticking out of where the cartridge goes in. I thought, wow, this is what they do here. And they had the ROM chips placed into the circuit board for a beta version of they weren't called betas back then, they were just EPROMs. And it had Sonic running down a hill, outrunning an apple rolling down a hill. Now, if there's any big Sega heads here, you'd know that that's actually from Castle of Illusion, Mickey Mouse. So they actually borrowed it. They took it out of Sonic eventually and put it into Mickey Mouse instead. So that, for me, I'll never be able to forget that. That's something special. Also, getting to dress up as Sonic at roadshow events.
Or it didn't happen.
What's that? Sorry?
Pictures or it didn't happen. You have any pictures of you dressed up as Sonic?
We've got one. I've only got one photo, because you got to remember, this is before everyone had a mobile. And I've only got a handful of photos that we didn't document anything from the day, which is my biggest regret. There is one video that I've got, though, from inside the hotline. And when I reach 100 subscribers, I am going to be posting that video on my channel. But I have got one photo of Sonic going up an escalator. That was pretty funny.
That's awesome. Sonic was like my favorite game when I was a kid. Like, I remember coming down Christmas morning and my parents got me Sonic 3D for the Genesis, and I lost my shit.
I was actually playing some Sonic 2 on last weekend. It was great.
Lost you.
Oh.
Well, there he is.
Okay, he's back again.
Yeah, sorry about that. I had my mic muted because I have a train going by. But, yeah, I was playing Sonic 2 on the weekend. Please tell me that the chemical zone was not your idea.
Oh, God.
If it was, we can't be friends anymore. The chemical plant zone?
No, I had nothing to do with it. Okay. I'll tell you what, though. With Sonic 2, I'm actually staring at my Mega Drive and Mega CD now, and I've got Sonic and Knuckles in there with Sonic 2 up on top of it.
I love the Sonic and Knuckles cartridge. It's so cool. I wish you would have done that with
more
games.
Isn't it unique? It's like DLC before DLC ever was a thing. And my copy of Sonic 2 is rather unique. It was actually given out to all Sega staff members before they had finalized the artwork for the cover. So mine has just got, and I wish I had looked after it a little more. It's just got Sonic the Hedgehog 2 written on it in a sticker that's blue and white. That's it. There's no artwork or anything for it. So
that's really cool.
At least I've got something like that from it. I don't have much stuff or memorabilia from the Sega days. I wish I had it held on to more.
Ooh, I am so jealous of that Sonic 2 cart you're talking about right now. Man, that's cool. Because I've just really started collecting in like the last couple of years or so. And I just, like, I don't have a lot of extra income, so I don't go out and buy a whole bunch of stuff. But the stuff I try to find is the stuff like that, like, you know, maybe you find it in... I had a copy of, actually, Dragon Warrior 7, which I guess was the biggest selling game ever in Japan, but here it's super rare. I bought a PS2 with a whole bunch of games, and it was in there. And that's like, that's how I find most of my collection, but man, that Sega card, I'm so jealous. That's awesome, man.
There's all these Sonic history card. There.
Yeah.
I just wish I had more. That's, but I'm glad I've at least got that.
Yeah, that's awesome. Like, that's the centerpiece. That'd be the centerpiece to any collection, in my opinion. I love Sega. I've always, because I never had any friends. I had a friend for, like, I don't know, 2 weeks before he moved. He got a Super Nintendo. And then he moved out of the town. So I didn't really get too much Super Nintendo back in the day, but don't get me wrong, I love Super Nintendo, but Sega Genesis is where it's at for me.
Oh, I just wasn't a Nintendo fan back in the day. I wasn't, like, it looked cool, and I thought, yeah, this is really great. But when I went to the arcades, and you would see Space Harrier and Outrun and Afterburner and these type of games in the cabinets, they were crazy. You'd get in them. It wasn't just a game. It was an experience. It was a ride. Mm-hmm. And then when I found out that they actually developed home consoles, I was thinking, well, that's cool. If I can get that arcade experience somehow in my house, that'd be awesome. Of course, the gaming industry has changed. When the Mega Drive was first being marketed, it was marketed as an arcade machine for the home, but they quickly realized that arcade experiences only are meant to be to keep getting people pumping in quarters or 20-cent coins, as it is here. And that's not going to be enough to keep people coming back and buying more games. They had to make the more longer, bigger, fully fleshed out experiences like Sonic the Hedgehog, which that's what that game was designed to address, that problem.
And thank God they did, because we never would have got Phantasy Star or Shining Force, so they didn't figure that out.
I tweeted a picture of Phantasy Star 2 because someone asked, name a great game from 1989, and I just instantly thought of Phantasy Star 2. I tweeted a picture of the end boss. I've got like 50 likes for that so far, just in 24 hours.
I didn't even see that. I must have missed that one. I'll look for it though. I haven't played much of Phantasy Star 2, but I've played the hell out of 4. I don't think I ever beat it, but I got so close you could taste it, kind of thing. But, and Shining Force 2 was the first game I ever beat. I didn't even own a Sega. My buddy had it. And I would go to his house and sleep over and rent it. And he'd go to bed. He'd tire out around midnight or 2 o'clock. And I'd stay up. He'd get up in the morning. And I'd still be playing Shining Force, trying to beat it. And I did eventually. It was awesome. Like, I'd bring it back and I'd rent it again immediately. Like, all my allowance money went towards renting that game so that I could keep my save file. And I eventually beat it.
That's awesome.
Yeah, that was good times. I'll still play Shining Force. If I play it, I play it for hours and hours. I can't just sit and play one battle. I gotta go.
I've seen you play it. It's super, like, it's fun to watch, even, you know.
Yeah. Well, yeah, because those fucking cool battles, they like zoom in. Oh, that's what got me. That's what got me hooked. I know.
I'm trying to track down a copy of that on the Mega CD, because apparently that's like the ultimate version of that game.
Yeah, Shining Force 3. I tried to, I'll admit it, I tried to pirate it once. It didn't work. I got about an hour of playtime in, and the game just completely, and then it wouldn't start again. But I was desperate. I needed to try it.
Hey, Brian, I've got something for you here.
Yeah, sure.
When you worked at the magazine, what kind of work was required? You know, daily duties, kind of writing, or anything else?
Yeah, so we would just clock in and we'd be on the phones most of the time. And the computer screens that we had back then were green monochrome screens. They were not, like, you didn't have any screenshots to refer off or anything like that. We had printed out paperwork that we got from Sega of America. Sega of America. we would also write our own maps. I've still got some of those maps. Some of them were sent in from fans out there, which was my first clue that gamers were full on. And before working at Sega, I didn't realize that there were other people out there that really just lived and breathed video gaming like I was doing at the time. And there's one that I've got up there. This guy had played Phantasy Star, the original Master System version. He had fully fleshed out color maps. He sent them in. I would love to track that guy down now, what is it, 25 years or so later, and try and see if I can get this posted and say, hey, man, thanks for sending that in. Because we wrote back to him, but we never got a response back to see if he got that or not. It's just
he probably insane. Went on to start Brady Games and did all those magazines or those steelbooks.
Thing. Who knows?
Or the books or whatever.
Yeah. So not only did we have to take calls from all over Australia, we would also get asked for reviewing games for marketing purposes. So we would get a game in and say, yeah, I think this is going to do really well, or this just plain sucks, whatever was the case. And we'd get those games, not on cartridge, obviously, because they were not fully developed at that stage. They would send them in tubes of chips, computer chips that you'd have to put into an EEPROM board to put into the cartridge slots. And someone found out later, because I still keep in touch with the other SEGA hotline staff members, or SEGA masters as we called ourselves, we found out that those chips, which contained, you know, not fully finished games and half completed games, or some games that just never got released, could you imagine having access to that now?
Oh man, well, someone, it'd be leaked immediately.
Someone threw them out.
Oh
no. Oh, my head, just, my heart just caved in when I heard this. And I've just gone, are you kidding me? I would have stolen them if I had have known that it was going to happen.
I want to curl up in a ball and cry now, you guys.
I would rather be done for theft than steal that, because that, to me, was a bigger crime.
Right.
That was far bigger crime than me stealing them.
Man.
Yeah. So
not just video games. That kind of thing happens all the time when people has the value of what it have, or it hasn't become valuable yet. So,
well, like the Doctor Who early seasons, BBC yeah, just like got, taped
BBC
over
had a scrapping like policy. Yeah, and
they did that here in Australia. There was a music show called Countdown in the 70s and 80s, and they used to get the big acts at the time that other countries were just jealous that we managed to get and they couldn't. And we had AC/DC recording sessions filmed over because they wanted to recycle the tapes.
Dongvers, you do not tell your dad about that.
Yeah.
He will Jesus. Go just insane.
And just quickly, I want to put this out there. I do have a bit of a connection to AC/DC. My uncle used to get plastered drunk with Bon Scott back in the day. He turns up late at night to my auntie's place with Bon Scott in his arm and 3 o'clock in the morning knocks on the door and says, I'd like you to meet someone. My auntie goes, yeah, I know who that is. This is the first time you brought someone decent back to the place. That's a true story.
That is awesome. Seem to be connected to everybody. Are you connected to the royal family too, or what?
They're British, no. You wanker.
And AC/DC's Australia?
Yeah, AC/DC is Australian.
Sydney no, I meant the royal family's British.
Yeah,
no. Yeah, I was just bugging. I knew where you come from. Just being a dick.
What a dick.
So, but yeah, that's my favorite memories of working at the hotline. I've got heaps more, but as the years roll on, it's getting harder and harder to remember them. We don't have the photos or the videos or the, you know, the stuff that the kids have got access to now. Geez, I sound old. But, you know, I just wish we had recorded more. That's my biggest regret of when working on the hotline. And also working in the game shop, the Gamesman. So I will try and do a plug for a video for later. They have a shop which is just local around here, and they have a retro section of the game store, which is on par with some of the stuff I've seen in Japan. It's just absolutely unreal, that the stuff that they've got in there. They've got all the gaming watches, all the Intellivision, ColecoVision stuff.
I used to own an Intellivision and a ColecoVision back in the day. I mean, my dad owned the Intellivision. There's like the little keyboard one you plugged into the TV. I used to Spider Side all the time. That was crazy. And then me and my buddy, the same one who actually got the Super Nintendo and then moved right away, we bought a ColecoVision at a garage sale for $20 when we were like in grade 4. It was awesome. His mom wouldn't let us play the Dungeons and Dragons game because she was religious and she thought it was evil, but we just waited until she went to bed and played it anyway.
Witchcraft.
It was definitely witchcraft.
Actually, that would actually be a real thing, but wow, that's insane.
Yeah, well, you know, sometimes I don't want to get into it because people will get mad.
Yeah, moving right along.
Yeah. Oh. Actually, yeah, Jace, why don't you go ahead with your next one?
Sure. So which game did you get the most questions about on the hotline, Brian?
Easily, without a doubt, Alex Kidd in Miracle World. It was the built-in game for the Sega Master System. So just to put you in the picture a little bit, here in Australia, Sega actually was heavily marketed in this country and actually won the console battle in this country. They were more popular. You might get a few people comment below saying, oh, wait, Nintendo was bigger, but sales-wise, Sega was far bigger up until the Sega Saturn came out, and then they started losing the battle.
Yeah, they kind of started losing that battle worldwide when the Saturn came out.
32X and all the rest of the add-ons, just people that had put their hands up in the air and said, enough's enough. But no, that was the built-in game to the Sega Master System 1 and 2. Most of Sega Master System 1's had it. And I was lucky enough to have actually played that game on cartridge, which is rare as hen's teeth now. I'd love to get my hands on that now. And that was enough to get me hired as well. So when one of the first questions they asked me, have you played Alex Kidd in Miracle World? And I said, yeah, we've beaten it a few times. You're in.
Nice.
So, and there were some calls that would drop in. Welcome to Sega Hotline. You're speaking with Brian. Let me guess, you're stuck in a room and there's a ghost that keeps killing and you don't know what to do. Oh man, you're good.
Well, that's surprising. I thought for sure it would have been one of the RPGs like Phantasy Star or something.
Oh, we had guys dedicated to that, but you got to remember that back in that era, the RPGs didn't get sold nearly as much as they should have. Not like today. Even today, the RPGs don't sell as well as your Call of Duties, for example.
Yeah, maybe a Skyrim. That'd be about it.
But we do have, we did have guys set aside for Phantasy Star 1 and 2. There was a hint book with 2, so that wasn't needed as much. We had one couple that would call up for Phantasy Star every step of the way. We called them the mother and son team. And they were from Canberra, and the guy was like at least in his 40s, and his mum was older, of course. And they would constantly call in every step of the way. They finally finished it 6 months down the track. And we'd be like, oh, thank God they finished it now. And they're like, oh, thank you so much. You guys have been wonderful. And we're now going to get that new, what's it called, Mega Drive. And I believe they've got the new game for that one. And we're thinking, no.
Oh, didn't they have to pay? Like every time they've called in, wouldn't they have to pay?
No, so this was before the whole pay model came in. They were talking that up just as I left, and we had back then it was 00055 call now and all this sort of stuff, and you'd have to get your mother's permission before you called. That all just kicked in just as I left it. But back then it was a service that you got as a Sega customer, and you had to be a member of the Sega club to get cheats, and we'd have kids.
Okay.
You'll see it in a video that if I find it, it's in the garage in the VHS somewhere. They'd always call up trying to trick us into saying that, I'm a member. And you, okay, so what's your number? I lost a card. So that was like our daily experience. And I kind of got jaded with having to get them to be a member before giving out stuff. I just wanted to tell them the codes and stuff because I figured that if they're Sega members, if they're Sega customers, that should all be enough to get cheats and whatever on that hotline.
Huh. It makes sense. And actually, you know what? I heard that Nintendo just finally stopped their customer, because there's that number on the bottom of your Nintendo. You could call that up until like 2015 and they'd still help you out for free.
I'm sorry, that's insane. That I know, is awesome. Like, that really is
that,
awesome.
That's good customer service right there. I can't believe that. Like, that's awesome. But, I mean, okay, you know what? We'll move on. I didn't realize this was going to take so long. I put way too much stuff on this podcast.
Sorry, I crap on a bit.
Oh, that's so do we all. It's funny because we usually aim for 45 minutes for the podcast. The first one was an hour and 20 minutes, so.
Yeah, we cut it short, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, we did. We cut some stuff out of it. Like, just in the middle, we decided we'll cut this out. You got another couple questions here, Brian. We'll do yours, and then, yeah, we'll just do what's on the list. That'll be perfect.
Yeah, so I've just got here that what's the hardest games you can remember playing, or hardest game, I should say, but you loved it so much that you didn't care, and you just kept coming back for more like a real sucker.
I'll go first. I definitely think I had a PS2, and I was so into like Final Fantasy style RPGs, like turn based stuff, but I never had one myself. I remember watching my buddy Duck, is what we called him, and he had he would play Final Fantasy 2, I think. I can't remember, but I was just so enthralled by it. I was just like, oh man, this is so awesome. So I finally saved up enough money. I went and bought a PS2 game, and it was Grandia 2.
Ah, yes.
Yeah, and I played the shit out of that game, and I remember being so mad at that game. Like, I would like stop playing for like a half an hour, then I'd be like, well, maybe I'll just try it again. Like, you know, whatever. And like, but like, just being enraged, a little Dongver is just mad as hell at this game, and like, but yeah, I always did come back to it, and I eventually did beat it, but it was like one of the hardest games I've ever played.
Man, I just sent that in to be sold like 2 months ago. I wish I would have known that. I would have maybe kept it and given it a whirl.
Yeah.
Well, for me, it was. I think this game came out on the Dreamcast originally, but it was ported to the original Xbox. And it's not necessarily the hardest game, but there are parts of it that are super hard. You have to have, like, just robot reflexes, and that's Shenmue 2.
I knew you were going to say that. I don't know why. Yeah. I just had a feeling it was getting down that way. Yeah.
I still love that game, and, like, it never... You know, like it has so much replay value, is what I'm trying to say. And just like even playing the mini games in the game, like Lucky Hit, you can sit there and play that for hours. And then the arm wrestling, when you have to, it's just tap X or tap A over and over. But for the hard levels, oh man! And then learning, you get to the boss stages where you have to win fights, and you know, and you're in the Dragon Quarter, and you have to win all the three, and it's basically, I can't remember. What other Sega game they took the Warriors from, but that game, it just has parts of it that are so hard, and there's so many, like, not Easter eggs, but hidden parts of it, and I just keep playing through it, and I always go back to it. It's great. I really want Shenmue 3 to come out. I've wanted to ever since I finished Shenmue 2, and I'm waiting.
Absolutely worship Shenmue, and I want to visit the township. And one day, I've been to Japan now 6 times. I'm going on my 7th trip. Still haven't been to that Yokohama township that's down in that way. One day I'll do it. But yeah, I just remember my first trip to Japan thinking, mm-hmm. Oh my God, this is just like Shenmue. This is just like Shenmue. Every time that just stupid little things like the light switches, the housing, the way they've got their walls all set up. It was just the amount of detail that was in that game for that time. It's just not enough credit.
Insane. 4 CDs on the Dreamcast, I think it was.
I think so. Shenmue 1 had 3 CDs, I think it was. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And, I never did play Shenmue 1, but I watched a ton of content on YouTube about it just so I could get the backstory.
I've got a watch from that game, the actual watch that he has, Ryu.
No way.
Yeah, I hunted it down on eBay, and that's one of my that's in my display cabinet along with the gaming watches and all the other stuff that I've got that I highly prize. Yeah.
That's awesome. Actually, you know what? I have a copy of Shenmue 2 that I kept because you loved it so much, Gord.
Oh man, I have my copy.
It's got a big scratch on it. I got to put it through my my disc fixer again, but I think it'll work. My copy. It was working fine when I played it. My copy's
still great, so I'll hang on to it.
Well, mine was second hand when I got it, so.
Yeah, no, that's
maybe cool. Third hand the way it looked. Whew, it was bad. The first time I put it through the thing the first time, and all but that one big scratch came out. So I think it'll be fine.
But what about you, Conrad? What's the hardest game for you?
Well, as anyone who's watched our channel knows, I am not very good at video games.
And I gotta say, man, to admit it,
man, I want to say Dark Souls, but I might have given up on Dark Souls because
give it time.
God damn it. I can't. There's this like night guy, and he's in like one of the first levels, and I just can't get past him. I've tried everything. I've had him so close. Yeah, it's. Anyway. But honestly, I think it's probably Jurassic Park for Sega Genesis. I couldn't get past the first level as a kid, ever. With the Raptor or with. What's his name there? Alan Grant. And when I started my collection for Genesis, it was the first game I bought. And I still can't get past the third level. But I'm going to get there. I'm going to get it. One of these days, I'm going to get it.
That's a let's play waiting to happen.
Oh, it's that's a let's fail waiting to happen right there. We got a couple of those in the channel, eh, Dongvers? Although, I want to get you. You got to.
It's not my fault.
I'm going to track down that Shinobi, man. And we're going to.
Yeah, that game was fun.
I think with an actual Genesis controller and not the crappy. Because we tried to play it on thing, Xbox. Too.
I'm actually staring at that now. I've got the Revenge of Shinobi, but this is the Mega CD pack-in version that they've got. The box there. I've got to get that on the channel.
Man, I remember Booger Man, too. That was one of my favorite games. I was like, the best game, Booger Man. Oh.
That was a rare one, too, I think. I don't think many people bought it. They tried to kickstart one, but it didn't go. Yeah, Brian, what was yours?
Yeah, it'd have to be Super Ghouls and Ghosts on Super Nintendo.
I forgot about that.
It's just cruel, unforgiving, but gorgeous to look at. The music is fantastic. You just keep wanting to push yourself on. It's like a bad relationship.
It hurts so good.
It hurts so good, yeah. So you know that the game is awesome and you should be dedicating everything to it, but it's just unforgiving. You get hit once, you become a duck. You lose your armor, and that's it. There's no we'll let you have five hits and then you die. Nah, it's just one hit after that, you're dead.
Yeah. That might be the first game I ever rage quit. And I have a long history of rage quitting games. Oh man, it was just so hard. I couldn't enjoy it because I was so bad at it. That if you're only playing for a minute, you don't get any enjoyment out of it. Like it's especially when you're passing the controller around with five or six other guys.
Oh, geez, that's one way to end relationships. There, friendships.
It was always nice. Sucks. I got to see a fair amount of the game. I don't think we ever beat it, but my one buddy Russ got fairly far in it, at least one time, and we were all sitting there watching. But we never did get anywhere close to the end. I don't think. Well, that's a good one, man. Whew. I forgot about that. That is a rough one. That'd be a good watch Poseidon cry video for Halloween.
Let's cries.
Let's cries. All right, moving right along. Brian, this one's just for you because we don't live there. Australia, I don't know, for any of our viewers that don't know, some games just get straight up banned for almost no reason. Have you ever missed out on a game because of that? And if not, if so, which ones? And if not, how did you get around it?
I personally haven't gone out of my way to get a game that has been banned. I just figured that there's just so many other games out there on the market, it's just not worth losing sleep over. The only one game that did get touched or did get sort of manipulated that I really hate is... the South Park Stick of Truth.
I've seen that. Wait,
that was banned?
No, and they changed
it. It wasn't banned, but they edited some scenes out of it. And I'm thinking, if you are buying a South Park game, you are not expecting it to be about a bunch of kids holding hands and singing Kumbaya. It's just it is a full-on experience, and you shouldn't be editing that stuff out of it, because that's what South Park is about.
And yeah, it is.
I do love how they got around it to a degree. They'd have the audio playing, and they'd have a picture of a koala crying on the tree, like looking all sad faced.
Yeah, you guys actually got the better one, because the European version had like the EU flag or something like that instead of the koala crying.
For me was, and also if you go to South Park's website to watch videos in Australia, and they're banned, well, they're not banned, but they haven't got the rights to show them here, you'll see a picture of Russell Crowe fighting around the world. Sorry, mate, but this video is not available in your part of the world. Terribly sorry about that.
Oh, I've never tried. There's got to be something in Canada that we can't watch from it. And they did have that Mountie character in a few episodes of Terrence and Phillip.
I don't know, man. Canada's pretty liberal when it comes to ratings. Like, even Deadpool was 14. That's it.
No, Deadpool was rated R, wasn't it?
In the States, not here.
It wasn't here, really.
There is a game that's banned in New Zealand, and even owning a copy of it apparently will get you in big trouble with the police.
Oh, really? No, what game is that?
And I think when you hear the name of the title of it, it's pretty obvious. Rape Lay.
Oh, yeah. That sounds like it probably should be banned everywhere.
Is that a shoot 'em up? No, okay. Shoot 'em up.
I mean, a lot of the CGI work for that game.
Of course you did.
For free.
I just did a pro bono. I thought, you know, the world needs a game like Rape Lay.
But yeah, just owning a copy of that game and technically can get you into trouble. Whether it will actually happen or not, I don't know.
I mean, it kind of makes sense. I've never played it, obviously, but I've heard about it. And it when you're looking at like the critics who will talk about anything,
mm-hmm.
and they're clearly uncomfortable mentioning that game, you know it's bad. Like, Jim Sterling cringed when he was talking about it on one of his things. And, I mean, that dude is unflappable.
So the reason for its ban is tends to promote and support the use of violence to compel a person to submit a sexual conduct. To submit to sexual conduct and the exploitation of young persons for sexual purposes. Yeah, I think that's a good reason to ban a game.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I'm right there with you on that one. I mean, there's got to be a line we might have found.
Yeah, that would be it. All right, and Brian, you had one final question before we do shout-outs.
Yeah, so with the Nintendo Switch coming out, did anyone catch that reveal?
Yep.
Yeah, so would you be buying it next March? I think I've already got a vibe from one or two of you that no. But, yeah, I'll put it out there. Who's excited for it, or at least curious?
I'm definitely curious about it, but like I said before, I don't pay full price for consoles, so I definitely won't be buying it in March. But hey, you never know. A little way down the road, if I find a good used one for cheap or something, yeah, I'd probably go for it. Seems kind of neat. I'm not really too much into handhelds. I mean, I have a DS and a PSP, but 90% of the time I just use them to test games to sell. That's about all I use them for.
I mean, if a Pokemon game comes out for it, I probably will, but...
We got a buyer. We got one, then. Yeah. Yeah.
Only if it launches with Pokemon.
Yeah, it does look pretty neat.
It won't launch with it, though. I think that they've got, Sun and Moon out now. They've never made any announcements about any Pokemon game for this new machine. I think if there was a Pokemon coming out for it, they would have at least dropped the hint by now. So,
yeah, definitely. I think so, too.
Oh, yeah, they would not let that one just slide by. They would jump on it.
But I think they're going to try and milk their sales from Sun and Moon. I think maybe towards Christmas next year you might see possibly a hint of a Pokemon coming out for the... I was going to call it the NX. Sorry, the Switch.
Yeah. Yeah, I know. I kept calling the NX, too.
Huh.
What about you, Gordon?
Yeah, I'm kind of like you. I wouldn't get the first release Gen 1 kind of thing, because all these consoles and or Galaxy Note 7, they have things like, remember when the 360 first came out?
It's going to explode on you.
Yeah. Well, the when the Xbox 360 first came out, the power cord, it has a huge, I don't know, amplifier, converter, whatever it is.
Yeah, that big.
And it would start on fire, too. And so, you know, they fixed that in Gen 2, and then Gen 2 was super bad with the disc trays, and then, the, you know, then the Elite came out. I probably wouldn't wait till, you know, the Switch, Super Switch came out or whatever, but
Nintendo's I would wait. Pretty good, though. They've always, I don't remember, and maybe Brian would remember more, I don't remember Nintendo having a problem with consoles yet.
The only thing I can think of with, and this is not any in any way a hindrance on it on the way it performs, but the color from the fire retarded chemicals that they use on the Super Nintendo, like I'm looking at mine now. Yeah. The bottom yellow, the bottom half of it's yellow. The top part looks fine. So
yeah,
sun will do that. Apart from that, it never gets the sun. It's just general.
Oh really?
Okay. Light, general light, and apart from that though, I'm looking at it just here across from me now. GameCube, it's operating fine. A Super Nintendo next to it, and a Wii U. Well, we'll see what happens with the Wii U as it goes down the track. I've never had a problem with a Nintendo consoles. It's one thing you get to give them kudos for is that their consoles have got good build quality. But we're worried about the, like you said, with the Switch. The constant changing of the controllers, the Joy-Con 1 and a Joy-Con 2 or whatever they call it,
mm-hmm.
Is that going to wear out eventually as you keep swapping them in and out? Like,
that's
something
we've
got to keep an eye out. Yeah, there's a lot of clickable moving parts. Yeah. Kids are going to lose that crap. We know what kids are like. They mm-hmm. can't be trusted.
Maybe that's part of their marketing. They're like, oh, well, let's just let the kids lose everything for it and just have to come back and give us like more money.
Apple's new earbuds there.
Oh man. I hate those channels. Generally, I hate those channels that wreck technology just for the sake of wrecking it. But I saw a video.
So did you see it? Yeah, go on, sorry.
The dude, like, took an Apple on one of the new iPhones. He's like, make your own headphone jack. And he just drilled a hole in it and told people it would work fine. I'm like, oh, it's like when they told him they could microwave it to make it waterproof all over again.
Oh, man.
People out there hacking into their Wii U gamepads and cutting off the left and right and saying, hey, look, I've got a Switch, like, yeah, okay.
Well, I don't know. If the Switch really is as good as it looks like on the trailer I saw for like gaming on the road, that would be so good for me. I spend a ton of time on the road for work, just hours a week. Just our work sites are hours away from where we are just because I'm in communications, right? So if that really is how it is and I can just set it up and game while I'm getting there. I mean, of course, not driving, although I might try. I would be really
set
into
stick,
that. Would be,
the sticks on each side of the steering wheel.
Yeah, just exactly. Tape the, I'd be really into that. So I'm looking forward to it, but again, I won't jump on it on release for sure.
I will probably try and find a way of getting it. I haven't got a means of getting it at this stage. That's the problem when you got mortgages. But if I had a means of getting one, yes, I definitely would be signing up because to get Zelda alone just for that game, that looks awesome, and to be able to play that on the go, I have a 1.5 hour commute each way for my work. That would be awesome to be able to chill out and block out the morons on the train with playing that.
And all those random Twitter messages those damn Carbon Knights guys send you. But actually, one more thing. Another reason I don't really have a motivation to get it, other than there is some cool, like that Zelda game looks pretty cool. I'm not big on cel shading, I never have been, but it still looks awesome. For the channel, like that's kind of, if I'm getting stuff, it's either to resell or it's for the channel. Generally, like if I happen to get something with something I'm reselling to put in my collection, I do that. But those will probably all make it onto the channel at some point. With Nintendo's crooked-ass policy of making you give them 60% of your ad revenue if you want to play their games on your channel, I don't have a motivation from that standpoint to get one.
We don't even we don't even have that option here. If there's any music on your channel, they'll claim all of it.
Oh, you have to sign up with Nintendo specifically for that.
We can't. It's not available in Australia.
Oh, it's not?
It's not available. Oh. No.
I wonder if it's available here. You know what? I've never actually looked into that.
And I've been posting Animal Crossings. Yes, guilty pleasure. I don't care what you say. Don't judge me.
I've been watching them. I think they're great.
Yeah, but I've been posting Animal Crossing stuff on there. And I did the DS Animal Crossing Wild World. And in the past, no one's been claiming music, so I've kept going with it. But someone claimed the music on the... on the DS version, and it wasn't Nintendo. So I looked into it. It's a company that published Nintendo music in Japan, and they're claiming it as their own.
Oh, yeah.
How can you win against this? You don't even know where you're going to get the strike from. So what do you do?
Well, we just avoid Nintendo completely. Like, we did Smash Brothers Let's Play, but then something else prevented us from putting it up. But, I mean, it would have been, we did a whole bunch of games that same night, and I guarantee you it would have been the last thing to go up. Because I know, just like my first Fallout video, I decided to leave the intro in, and it plays Blue Moon by, what's his name there?
Gone.
Anyway, yeah, it got claimed immediately. Like 30 seconds after the upload was done, boom, claimed. I was like, oh no! But whatever.
Breaks your heart too. But you can remove the music or you can edit it out.
Yeah, but I figured, you know what, I'll just leave it in. It's part of the intro, so I'll just after that, I made sure I shut off all the music in the game was shut off after that. So, and that's generally what I do. You can look it up online. There's a few places you can look. I usually just Google it and it ends up bringing me right to it. But you can find the, like, what companies will let you use their music and stuff like that. Or, like, if you're doing a Let's Play, some companies, they'll recommend you shut off the music in the game because they don't actually own it. They just own it for the game purposes. But if you're doing a Let's Play, it'll get claimed. And there's a lot of ins and outs. So before I start anything, I always make sure. I think that's why a lot of small channels just use indie games, because indie games are under the same thing. If they use copyrighted music, they'll get in trouble right away.
Yeah, yeah. So.
But we're not that safe, except for Dongvers. Time for shout-outs. The best part of the show, in my opinion. Although, tonight has been fantastic with Brian being here, I gotta say. This is the most fun we had yet, and we're way over time. I don't even give a shit. We're just going to keep going.
First two-hour podcast.
Yeah. I am so sorry for that. But
oh, hey, no, don't worry. It was all of us. Except for Dongvers. He said about four things all night. In fact, you know what? Dongvers, you're going to go first on the shout-outs.
All right, cool. I'm going to shout-out Juicy Monkey. Juicy Monkey Gaming, and he does a lot of first-person shooter stuff, which you guys know I like, and he's doing a lot of Destiny just came out with their newest expansion pack for Xbox One, so he's doing some of that, and he's good, like he's really good at the first-person shooters, so it's enjoyable to watch. I think there's some like music in there too, and it's good. I like it a lot.
Good.
And I think he has 17 subscribers. So,
oh, he's huge.
Wow.
Hopefully we can get him a few more.
Yeah.
Come on, Knights, get on it. If you like those first-person shooters, go see Juicy Monkey Gaming. All right. Yeah, sure. Go ahead, Beast.
Sure. My shout-out is channel Z-Star, or Z-Star.
If you're because they're Canadian, I get it.
Yeah,
I'm with you, buddy.
I still say Z somehow. I don't know.
Well, anyways, you're pretty close to the border down there.
I guess so. Yeah, but that's how they say it on their channel, Z Star. But see, there's a good mix of first person shooter, of RTS, and even a Hearthstone and another game called Armella, which is a lot like it. And it's the model of the channel is intellectual gaming, and they have quite a few lists of. While they're playing, they'll talk, you know, just like kind of with, you know, what we do in the podcast. Like, hey, do you think that the gaming industry is headed for another mini crash? They talk about things like that, you know, and different loadouts or like, hey, here's problems with competitive and Overwatch, which they do a lot of things like that, which is good for stimulating conversation and thought in the gaming community, which is always welcome in my view. So, I mean, yeah, Z-Star had 54 subscribers, 55 I got on my personal channel. So they're at 55 now, and hopefully they continue to grow with Overwatch and Civilization 6 and some Batman, all kinds of stuff on there.
Cool. Mm-hmm. So, oh, also, I forgot to mention, if you want to find these channels, they will all be in the description below when we're done here. And my choice, because we'll let Brian go last because he's our guest, my choice is actually kind of a buddy of mine on Twitter, buddy of ours, I guess, but I'm the one who runs the Twitter, so, and it's going to be Mumbles. I love me some Mumbles. He does all kinds of videos. He's got gaming videos, and then he'll do reviews for gaming stuff and for non-gaming stuff. I actually, one of my favorite reviews of his is for a hedge trimmer. And, I mean, you guys know how much I love gardening, so of course I watched it. And, yeah, we had a good little conversation in the comments about the time I cut the cord on my hedge trimmer, trying to trim the hedges. Yeah, that was a bad day. But, actually, no, it cut out right away because I got the...
Really?
I got the cord from the house. And it didn't get stuck in there. It just kind of flopped as it came out. I actually still use that cord in the greenhouse all the time. I fixed it up, and it works fine. It doesn't heat up, so it must be good. And Mumbles, this dude's growing fast. He started, I remember, I think we subscribed to Mumbles when he had like 25 or 30 subs. And that wasn't that long ago, and he's already up to 602. So I figured I better get him in before he passes 1,000 and doesn't count for our shoutouts anymore. So that's Mumbles. And actually, we've also been talking to Mumbles a little bit. And we're going to do a little Rocket League with him at some point.
Yes, sir. So
that'll be fun. I can't wait. And Brian, who is your shout-out?
Yeah, so this is a little bit of a different take on gaming. I like to try and get the Aussie gamers, the YouTubers, I should say, out there. We don't get as much exposure as the US, Canadian, and the English sites, but... this guy is a Nintendo fanboy, and he's a teacher. So his channel is called Mr. A Game. That's Mr. A hyphen Game. He does videos every Wednesdays and Saturdays. And as he always says, you better bring your A game. And he's currently, it's really interesting to watch a teacher doing these kind of videos because, you know, we're a bit of potty mouth, Mr. Swearbear over there being quiet, I hear you. but this guy has to, you know, he has to watch his P's and Q's because he's got his probably his classroom watching him. So I just find that fascinating that he's currently going through Paper Mario Color Splash, which is an awesome looking game, I must admit, for a Wii U. He's playing that currently at the moment, and he's up to 522 subscribers. I'd like to see that get pushed up. I think he deserves it.
Yeah. I'll definitely check them out. That sounds cool. I don't mind G-rated content. I just can't fucking do it.
We tried on this channel.
Actually, you know what? My Stardew Valley. I haven't sworn it yet. Oh, I was close. I was recording earlier, and there's something. I can't remember what it was. I almost dropped an S-bomb, but I changed it the last second. So, I think shelf. Son of a shelf. That doesn't even make sense. I don't care. Just leave me alone.
I try to pretend that there's kids watching.
You drop the occasional one, though. I've seen it a few times.
I have dropped one or two, yeah.
Well, it depends what I'm doing. My Summoner's War series is definitely for kids, but the Rocket League, not so much.
Oh, yeah. Hey, Dongvers, you got a good story?
Yeah, pretty much all mine.
I took mushrooms last weekend. Like, God damn it, Dongvers. What are you doing?
Listen, man.
Well, yeah. All of our any teaching videos we've done, like my Fallout loading screen fix and stuff like that. There's no swearing in that stuff either. But mm-hmm. I mean, when I'm gaming, like a lot of times, especially if the game has violence in it, my brain just switches to, you know, F-bomb mode, which is fine.
I mean, it doesn't even really need to. I mean, I'll go fishing in World of Warcraft and be swearing the whole time because.
I fished with you in real life, and it was the same thing.
Same thing.
But anyway, that is going to do it for tonight nights. I like it. Anyway, sorry. My brain is not working. If you want to ask a question for the podcast next month, you can do so by hitting us up in the comments of any of our videos on Reddit, on our Facebook page, or on Twitter, or you can email us at thecarbonknights@gmail.com as well. You get a little mini shout out of it. We say your name out and we'll put it in the comments. And if you want to enjoy any of the shout outs that we've mentioned, there'll also be a link in the comments. Oh boy, this is getting rough. And if you want to go see more of Brian at Since Spacies, we will also link him in the comments below. I want to thank Brian for being here, and I hope you get some subs out of this, and honestly, I hope we get a few too. That'd be nice. All you Aussies out there, we love you. We're Confederate brothers. Commonwealth brothers.
There you go. Brothers. Yes, yeah, the Commonwealth. Lord. Not full out full Commonwealth, though.
No. But, still. See you next time, Knights. Keep those shields up.